glad you found us. Barb was just telling us that you were at the other, we were wondering what the other conference was, so now we know. All right, well, we might as well get underway. Thank you so much for coming. My name's Lori Brinklow. I'm the coordinator of the UNESCO Chair in Island Studies and Sustainability and the Institute of Island Studies. Our offices are just down the hall, so if you have to go to the washroom, you have to go right by our office. The washrooms are the last doors on the left before you go around the corner. The Institute of Island Studies has been around for a goodly long time, and I see many friends of the Institute here in the audience tonight, people that I've known for many, many years, supporters and longtime friends. So glad to have you here. For those of you who are new, we are a research institute, started in 1982 part-time, 85 full-time, so we're over 30 years old. Harry Bagwell was the first director, and now we have, we don't have a director anymore. I'm the coordinator, and Jim Randall here is the chair of our executive committee. We do, we serve as a bridge between the university and the community. We do research on culture, environment, and everything special to do with Prince Edward Island and other islands. And so we have this lecture series that happens, come on in. We have a lecture series that happens, generally we do between 8 and 10 lectures a year. And we try and make it so that we have some Prince Edward Island content and some international content. So a couple of weeks ago, you might have been here, we had a fellow come from Alderney and talking about some of the interesting challenges that they have as a small island in the Channel Islands, trying to learn from Prince Edward Island and other islands, lessons that he can take back to his own island. Come on in, Tim Hay. So that's, we have a very active research program, a publishing program. I have a newsletter, and I'm going to get Jim to tell you a bit about that in a sec. And we have the Master of Arts in Island Studies program. So it's a pretty fun and interesting place to become involved with, and so glad to see so many friends here tonight. So I'll introduce you to Jim Randall, who is the UNESCO Chair in Island Studies and Sustainability, as well as the Chair of the Institute's Executive Committee.
Thanks, and Lori's sidekick, I guess. And I should say that I'm more than 30 years old as well, just like the Institute. I just wanted to point out, you see these sort of banners here. This one for the Institute of Island Studies points out two things that I think are useful to think of, even in terms of this talk tonight. Because the first one says, encouraging a deep knowledge, understanding, and expression of Prince Edward Island. And this, of course, you can't get to be more than Prince Edward Island than the work of Lucy Maud. But at the same time down here, we also say undertaking studies of local, national, and world islands. And what we do in the Institute is really do a lot of facilitating. We develop networks and reach out to different people that do island-type research and public engagement around the world. And we bring people together. And so once again, the topic tonight, both through our institute, and I'm glad we're involving another institute here, Kate being involved in another institute as well that she may talk about, and reaching out to the work that's taking place around the world on Lucy Maud. So without further ado, I just want to say that Lori mentioned a newsletter. We do have a digital newsletter that goes out on all things island studies. It tends to go out sort of once every month. We will not inundate your mailbox, but if you want to find out about upcoming events related to island studies, then we'd be happy to add you to that newsletter list. If you're already on it, don't put your name down here. If you are, if you're not on it and you want to be, just add your name and email address. And we promise not to sell this email list to any political organizations. So I don't know if you're on the list, Robert, but pass it on if you're.
Okay.
All right.
Great, thanks, Jim. He's on the list, definitely. All right, let me introduce Kate Scarth. Dr. Kate Scarth fell in love with Ella Montgomery and Anne of Green Gables at a very young age. When she was 8, she and her family came from Newfoundland to PEI for a visit. Kate was the family's self-appointed tour guide. She went on to do her PhD in English at University of Warwick. She now finds herself the inaugural chair of Ella Montgomery Studies in Applied Communication, Leadership and Culture, which we fondly call the ACLC program around here at UPEI. her office is on the ground floor underneath ours, just down at the end, so it's always fun to see her in the hallway. She teaches the ACLC courses, Putting Arts to Work, Digital Literacy, and Digital Humanities. So you can see that her interests range even beyond Alan Montgomery. Her research focuses on English and Canadian literature written from the 18th to the early 20th century, and she is particularly interested in fiction about urbanism and the environment. Her book, Romantic Suburbs, Fashion, Sensibility, and Greater London, is under contract with the University of Toronto Press, and I hope you'll tell us more about that. She is also leading a digital humanities public engagement project, which includes a mobile app and website supporting a literary walking tour of Halifax, Nova Scotia. Kate is on the program of the upcoming Ella Montgomery Conference, which is the 13th. Hard to believe that they've had that many. It's fantastic that it keeps coming around again and again, called Ella Montgomery in Reading. It's here June 21st to 24th at UPEI. And on June 20th, you can take a pre-conference workshop with her called Ella Montgomery and Public Engagement, New Readers, New Ways of Reading. So glad to have you here, Kate, and welcome.
To Lori and Jim for having me here, for inviting me to give this talk, and to everyone for coming. As Jim mentioned, I am part of an institute here at UPEI, the Ella Montgomery Institute. So if you're interested in Montgomery at all, check out what we're doing. There's a lot of exciting projects going on right now. Philip, Rosemary, and I, for instance, have been working on an online course. And as Lori mentioned, we have a conference coming up in June. And I have conference postcards, so if anyone's interested, you can come get one after the talk. And the Institute's website is there too, yes. So you can find out more about us there. So to start, I'm actually going to start with rural Montgomery. Because, of course, when we think of Anna Green Gables and Montgomery, we generally think about rural Prince Edward Island. So, of course, the iconic farmhouse of Green Gables. Rural farming communities, and particularly Avonlea, a fictional version of Cavendish, and then of the North Shore generally, so the beaches of the North Shore. And of course, Green Gables has given its name to the whole tourism region on the island. And Montgomery's rural island is, of course, reflected in her own writings, in film adaptations from Kevin Sullivan's 1980s miniseries to the new Netflix and CBC, Anne with an E. And of course, in the many tourist sites like Green Gables that celebrate the author and her writing. But this presentation takes a different tact. Today we're going to be looking at urban Montgomery, and more specifically, urban Anne. So we follow Anna Green Gables today to urban PEI, and specifically to Charlottetown and Summerside. So while the rural looms large in Montgomery's life and works, and I'm definitely not arguing with that, Montgomery was also a chronicler of urban Canada. So she wrote journals and letters about her life in places like Prince Albert, Saskatchewan, Charlottetown, Halifax, and Toronto. And several of her novels have significant urban settings. So in Anna Green Gables, the first of Montgomery's novels, Anne goes to Queen's College, which is a fictional version of Prince of Wales College, which of course is one of the founding institutions of UPEI. And in Anne and Windy Poplars, a later novel in the Anne series, Anne is the principal of the Summerside High School. So Summerside and Charlottetown are the two towns, as I said, I'll talk about, and these are the two novels that I'll focus on this evening. So for those of you who are needing a bit of a refresher on these two novels, I'll give you a couple quick and dirty synopses now. Okay. And what I'll do, I'll just fill in details as we go along, as is necessary. So we'll get to this late in a minute. So in Anna Green Gables is the first novel in the series, of course. Anne is an orphan who's adopted by Marilla and Matthew Cuthbert in Avonlea. And various hijinks follow. So of course, the slight incident where Gilbert Bly not only draws attention to Anne's red hair, but actually calls her carrots. And then later on, she tries to dye that hair black, but you can see here it doesn't really go to plan. And then later on, she gets her best friend Diana drunk. But later on, a more mature Anne attends Queen's Academy in Charlottetown. And so that's the section of the novel I'll focus on in this talk. And Montgomery herself was a graduate of Prince of Wales College, so Queen's real-life counterpart. She attended Prince of Wales in the 1890s. So this is the building that she would have attended, which is where Holland College is today in downtown Charlottetown. So Montgomery had some real-life experiences to draw on when she wrote Anne's year at college. Now, Anna Wendy Poplars might be a little less familiar to some of you, although if you're familiar with the second of the Kevin Sullivan movies from the 80s, that one's loosely based on Anna Wendy Poplars. So at this point, Anne's gone through her year at Queen's in Charlottetown. She's gone away to Kingsport, which is a fictional Halifax, and has completed an undergraduate degree. She's not only gotten over the slight incident with Gilbert, but is actually engaged to him at this point. And Gilbert is a medical student at Redmond, a fictional Dalhousie. And most importantly, as I mentioned already, she's the principal of Summerside High School. And Montgomery herself visited Summerside several times. And here is an excerpt from her journal talking about a visit to Summerside and having a wild ride home, racing home after being in Summerside. So although I'm going to be focusing on Charlottetown and Summerside, I wanted to give you a sense of Montgomery and her heroine's relationships with other Canadian cities. So Montgomery spent time in Prince Albert, Saskatchewan. After her mother died when she was quite small, her father moved out west. And then when she was a teenager, she spent a year in Prince Albert with him. Just to give you a bit of color from that time, Montgomery went to school in an old hotel in Prince Albert, and the hotel had multiple uses. So as well as being a classroom, the town council met there, the Freemasons met there. There was also a ballroom in this building, and the classroom was used as the dressing room for the ladies, so the students were always picking up hairpins off the floor. And then there was also the mounted police operated out of this building too. So Montgomery talks about all the drunks being hauled in every night to the jail cells right next to her classroom. So she was pretty clear that she wasn't in Cavendish anymore. Montgomery also had two stints in Halifax. So she was a Dalhousie student for 1 year, and the Forest Building, which is now part of the medical sciences program, is where Montgomery would have gone to class, the Forest Building. And there's actually going to be a plaque unveiled commemorating Montgomery's link with Dalhousie on June 3rd, so the next time you're in Halifax, you can go check that out. A few years later, Montgomery worked at the Halifax Echo at the newspaper, so she had these two experiences in Halifax to draw on when she wrote the third Anna Green Gables book, Anne of the Island. So in Anne of the Island, Anne goes to a fictional Dalhousie. And I like this cover because, as many of you might know, most of the Anna Green Gables covers or the Montgomery covers have rural PEI backdrops. So this one's actually reflecting the urban setting of this novel. This is a Polish translation. And thanks to Simon Lloyd for first, so I don't know why the Polish translator was, or the publisher was particularly interested in that urban setting, but there you go. So this presentation offers an urban dimension to a writer usually seen to be steeped in rural traditions, but who was very much writing about a Canada that was starting to become the urban nation it is today. So in the early 20th century, Canada had modernizing, globally linked, and growing towns and cities. And it was moving towards our reality today when over 80% of Canadians live in urban and suburban areas. So the presentation explores how one of the most insightful writers of PEIs and Canada's literary landscape grapples with these new urban landscapes. And she's particularly negotiating how these new and growing towns and cities fit into an island province and a nation that is traditionally rural and agriculturally based. So the rest of the presentation kind of falls into, I forgot to show you the talk about Toronto. Montgomery also lived in Toronto. She retired there, and her novel Jane of Lantern Hill has a lot of Toronto components. Okay, so now on to the next part of the presentation. So there's two main sections here. I'll start by overviewing the many pleasures, opportunities, and amenities that are associated with Charlottetown and Summerside, as represented in the Anne's books. So most significantly for Anne, towns are important important place is because of the educational opportunities and the possibility of upward mobility and economic independence for rural youth, including and especially women, and that comes out with her focus on AM. But despite Montgomery's representation of the many advantages of town, they never quite live up to Montgomery and Anne's beloved North Shore. And you might not be surprised to hear that. And towns are at their best for Montgomery when it's clear that they're towns on a rural island. Charlottetown newspapers, for example, are only seen to be showcasing the accomplishments of the Avonlea youth. Meanwhile, of all that the towns have to offer, from music and shops and shopping, Anne most enjoys the natural and rural features of Charlottetown and Summerside. So their trees, their parks, their seaside locations. In exploring towns' rural and natural features, Montgomery is most interested in how they benefit Anne. Towns bolster Anne's success, which can include everyday experiences like having a stress-relieving walk by the harbor or broader educational achievement allowed by a year studying to become a teacher in Charlottetown. So there's all kinds of ways that the nature and the cities kind of help Anne along. All right. So we'll start by talking about the good side of the towns. In the early 20th century, Montgomery was writing, Canadian cities and their suburbs were growing and offered amenities and possibilities like electric lights, fashionable shops, restaurants, secondary and post-secondary education that just weren't available in the countryside. And a really important amenity was the fact that Charlottetown and Summerside were both transportation hubs. So the ferry, for example, that first brings Anne from Nova Scotia to PEI when she's 11, when the novel opens, lands at Charlottetown, and that's where she gets on the train. So we can see here Anne first seeing PEI from the train leaving Charlottetown. So here she's first introduced to the red roads, a key feature of that PEI landscape that she'll come to love. And we're also introduced here to a key characteristic of Anne, her talkativeness, her inquisitiveness, her thirst for knowledge, her need to know why things are the way they are. But we also see Charlottetown being a key transportation link, linking the ferry and the train, connecting the mainland and urban and then rural PEI. And this ferry coming through Charlottetown, of course, allows for everything else that happens in the novels. It brings Anne to the island, allowing her to become Anne of Green Gables and then Anne of the island. Politics are another feature of Charlottetown in the novel. So here we see the Premier, the Prime Minister of Canada, coming to Charlottetown, and there was a monster mass meeting. We see a busybody, Rachel Lynn, who doesn't believe in suffrage for women, but is nonetheless a red-hot politician needing to go to Charlottetown to see the Prime Minister. And so she went to town and took her husband. Thomas would be useful in looking after the horse. So there's a certain irony here that a woman who doesn't believe that women should have the right to vote was so engaged in the political process, is obviously such a force at home and in her community, so she doesn't mind being on the opposite side of politics for most people in Avonlea. But for our purposes here, Charlottetown's an important political hub linking PEI to federal politics. In the Anne books, Charlottetown's also a cultural hub. We get references to the Academy of Music, the Charlottetown Symphony Club, a band playing in Victoria Park, and there's plays at the Summerside Town Hall. One thing that Montgomery and Anne both get really excited about is the pleasures of modern consumerism. So while people in Avonlea get their more everyday needs taken care of by shopping at Carmody shops, so that's a more nearby town to Avonlea, more luxurious goods come from Charlottetown and Summerside. So at least two pairs of pearls come from Charlottetown to Avonlea. Anne gets from a Charlottetown shop the daintiest little kid slippers with beaded toes and satin bows and glistening buckles. And she also sees a dark, richly red velvet hat in a Summerside shop. So we can see Anne and Montgomery really relishing in these consumer goods that you can see, you can window shop, you can buy in the town stores. Here we see ice cream being highlighted. So the fictional predecessor of cows, a Charlottetown ice cream shop and restaurant, is highlighted during Anne's first visit to Charlottetown after that initial arrival. So ice cream's a novelty in Avonlea, as has been captured in the song in Anne of Green Gables, the musical. But it's easily accessible in in Charlottetown and can cure all kinds of ills. So Anne's disappointed, the concert's over. She doesn't see how she was ever to return to common life again. And then Miss Barry, who's their hostess, suggests they go get ice cream. That sounded so prosaic, but to my surprise, I found it true. The ice cream is delicious, Merla, and it was so lovely and dissipated to be sitting there eating it at 11 o'clock at night. Diana said she believed she was born for city life. So again, there's this kind of relishing of urban pleasures, of the dissipated life of eating ice cream late at night. There's some more maybe practical amenities that are also associated with the towns. There's a hospital in Charlottetown. In Avonlea, they're often getting up charity concerts to fundraise for the hospital. Both Charlottetown and Summerside have banks, and Anne actually has to compete with the new banker in Summerside for her room and board. But it turns out they like her better, of course. And then Summerside also has a library and a hardware store, so you can see a little there's the library here. However, the most important thing about Summerside and Charlottetown for Montgomery is the emphasis on independence and education. So from early on in Anne of Green Gables, Charlottetown is most connected to economic independence for women, or is connected to economic independence for women. Diana's wealthy aunt, Josephine Barry, who you can see in the 1985 miniseries here, is the only Charlottetownian that we meet in Anne of Green Gables. We're not really sure how she made her money, but she lives alone, she's independent. At the same time, the economic status of women in Avonlea, like Rachel Lynn and Marilla, is undermined when their closest male relatives die. So when Matthew dies, Marilla considers selling her beloved home, Green Gables, and a widowed Rachel is made actually homeless and she has to move into Green Gables. Josephine Barry is not dependent on a man. There's no such disruptions in her life. But Montgomery's particularly interested in how this kind of idea of independence plays out with education. And there's a clear gender dynamic in terms of how Anne's relationship to post-secondary education is described. Montgomery herself struggled to access post-secondary education. For her to go to Queens for that one, or Prince of Wales College for that 1 year, her grandmother had to make various maneuvers behind the scenes, and she was only able to afford 1 year at Dalhousie, although she would have liked to continue for the full degree. At the same time, her male cousin had his full way paid for the 4 years at Dalhousie by her family, by their family. So Montgomery here gives Anne the support and understanding from the family that she herself didn't get. So we see here Marilla bringing up the suggestion of Anne going to Queens to become a teacher. She says, "I believe in a girl being fitted to earn her own living, whether she has to or not." And then later on, when Anne has finished her year at Queens, she's won a scholarship that will give her 4 years at university. She starts to worry about the fact that Matthew's getting older. And that, of course, you might remember from Anne of Green Gables that originally they wanted a boy, right? Because they wanted someone who could help on the farm. And Anne comes instead. So Anne's really worried now. She sees Matthew getting older. He doesn't have that support. And when she brings these worries to Matthew, he says, "Well, I'd rather have you than a dozen boys. Just mind you that, rather than a dozen boys. It wasn't a boy that took the AP scholarship. It was a girl, my girl that I'm proud of." So there's this emphasis that education in town is important for a young woman's economic independence, as we saw with Marilla, and then also her academic achievement is something to be celebrated. Then later, there's Summerside High School, and that's an important professional step for Anne. She's finished her teaching certification, her undergraduate degree, and she gets this position as principal. So again, town is linked to education and professional advancement. And I want to point out that towns are not only just important for women's access to education, but for rural youth generally. And from the movie, the miniseries version based on Wendy Poplar's, you might remember all the spats that Anne gets in with the wealthy Pringle family. But in fact, Montgomery makes a big deal in the novel about the mentorship that Anne does of rural youth who are struggling because of socioeconomic barriers in their education. So Lewis is one of these students, so he has to do housework to earn his board, and he's teased by the other students. But Montgomery tells us someday the laugh will be on the other side. His pockets might be empty, but his head wasn't. And under Anne's guidance, he ends up graduating. graduating and going on to McGill. So Montgomery, from her own experience, is keenly aware of the barriers and everyday stigma that poor rural youth at the turn of the 20th century faced when trying to access education. While her own post-secondary education was limited, or at least a lot more limited than she would have liked, she imagines all kinds of successes for her fictional characters as doctors, ministers, teachers, principals, actors, to name a few professions. So even if they go on to success in Montreal or the United States or elsewhere, Montgomery's young people owe part of their success to the education they received in PEI's towns. All right, so far so good. Charlottetown and Summerside are fun, they provide vital services, and they're important for the island's youth. However, given Montgomery and Anne's attachment to the North Shore, it's not surprising that towns don't always live up to Green Gables. So after her first visit to Charlottetown, Anne comes to the conclusion that she wasn't born for city life and she was glad of it. So she talks about how nice it was to be eating ice cream late at night, but at the end of the day, she'd rather be at home in her bed with the sounds of nature outside, knowing that she's home. And then she says, I told Miss Berry so at breakfast the next morning and she laughed. Miss Berry generally laughed at anything I said, even when I said the most solemn things. So Montgomery really drives her point home about how Avonlea is preferable to Charlottetown by having Anne's frenemy, Josie Pye, champion Charlottetown over Avonlea. So to give you a sense of Josie, in case you've forgotten how charming she can be, here's a snapshot of her personality. At one point we're told that Josie is just going to college for education's sake because she won't have to earn her own living. Josie says, of course, it is different with orphans who are living on charity. They have to hustle. Later, Josie catches a homesick Anne crying. You've been crying, remarked Josie with aggravating pity. I suppose you're homesick. Some people have so little self-control in that respect. I've no intention of being homesick, I can tell you. Town's too jolly after that pokey old Avonlea. I wonder how I ever existed there so long. You shouldn't cry, Anne. It isn't becoming. For your nose and eyes get red, and then you seem all red. I mean, that's the worst possible thing to say for her, right? So Josie, with that sharp tongue, prefers Jolly Town over Anne's beloved Avonlea. It's no endorsement, of course, on Montgomery's part of town life. But Montgomery definitely does not condone a rejection of town. We've already seen town's advantages, the amenities and opportunities they offer. And when less desirable parts of town become apparent in the Anne books, Montgomery just makes them more like Avonlea and rural PEI generally. So Charlottetown and Summerside are at their best in the Anne books when they showcase PEI's rural life. So at the Charlottetown Agricultural Exhibition or in the town's newspaper, for example. And towns are also at their best when their natural features, so their trees and their flowers, are easily accessible. So the Charlottetown exhibition showcases Avonlea people, goods, and talents. So after going to the exhibition, Anne comes home and tells Marilla all about the prizes that people from Avonlea have won. So for things like knitted lace, Gravenstein apples, pigs, paintings, homemade butter and cheese. And then she concludes this recap by saying, so Avonlea was pretty well represented, wasn't it? I mentioned before the city's newspapers, we only hear about them when they're showcasing the accomplishments of Avonlea youth, whether that's the money they've raised for the hospital or the pass list for Queens, which Anne, of course, leads. So again, there's this highlighting of the theme of town's importance in supporting PEI's youth. Charlottetown, as we've seen, is also integral to the island's education system. Avonlea and other rural island youth go to Charlottetown to be educated as teachers. When they go to write their Queen's entrance exam, Anne says, when we reached the academy, there were scores of students there from all over the island. Emphasizing that Queens and Charlottetown are educational hubs of the island, Queens graduates return to rural PEI to teach, and this all happens via town. So Anne was educated in Avonlea by teachers trained in town, and her own intellectual and professional development is propelled forward by this time at Queens and in Charlottetown. So Charlottetown absorbs and supports its rural hinterland, but as I've said, nature itself, so the physical components of nature, are really important in Montgomery's representation of towns. She really favors towns that have a lot of nature. So Anne imports what she appreciates about Avonlea and Green Gables to her understanding of urban landscapes. So in Charlottetown, some of the places that Anne interacts with are Victoria Park, and then the views from her windows. Views are really important. In Summerside, there are a lot more green spaces. So from her tower room, she has a tower bedroom. She can see the house's gardens, its trees and flowers, a maple grove, a graveyard lined with trees, a valley, the nearby countryside. The house is right on the edge of town, and of course the sea. And the tower room itself that she lives in is a quasi-natural place. So as well as offering these views of nature, the wind's always blowing through it, which Anne loves, because she, you know, she feels like she's at one with nature. So she writes to Gilbert how, "The winds a wail and sighing, croon around my tower, the white winds of winter, the green winds of spring, the blue winds of summer, the crimson winds of autumn, and the wild winds of all season. Some night, Gilbert, I'll open my tower casement and just step into the arms of the wind." So you can see how that little Anne Green Gables is just kind of translating her love of nature to town, and that her room is even a semi-natural place. You can see here that a lot of the covers of Anne of Windy Poplars highlight this focus on nature, and that's pretty typical for Montgomery books, but even though this novel is happening in a town, nature is really emphasized. I think on some of the covers, it's gesture towards the fact that Summerside is a town. Like we see Anne walking on a road in that middle yellow cover. She also strikes up a friendship with the little girl who lives next door to them, so who's just over the gate. And whereas in Avonlea, you know, your neighbors are far away because everyone has a farm, so there's more of a sense of a town set up here alongside the natural world. Anne has various different relationships with nature in town. Mm-hmm. So she goes walking a lot, sometimes she goes driving. There's that permeability of the tower room. There's a lot of her looking out at views of nature. And then nature's often a springboard to feeling and imagination. So nature is vital at Green Gables and in Avonlea for Anne. As many of you might remember, the Lake of Shining Waters, the Snow Queen, the tree outside her window, and the White Way of Delight. So, you know, this access to nature in town is key to her feeling like herself, feeling at home, feeling that connection to place. Nature is also central to her well-being in terms of dealing with homesickness and work stresses, and in Anne of Windy Poplars, missing Gilbert. For Montgomery, people and their surroundings, especially their natural surroundings, are integrated. So communities built by connecting with people and place, not just people. Nature is vital to Anne's dreaming and imagining, especially she imagines her future with Gilbert. And of course, dreaming and imagination are central to Anne, so it's also important to her feeling like herself. And all of this really reflects Montgomery's landscape aesthetics. A lot of you are probably, you know, remembering this kind of approach from the various Montgomery novels. It also reflects her literary heritage too, this kind of emphasis on a romantic attachment to nature, and that emotions and memory are all laid on into place. And of course, the deep connection to place is highlighted in the titles of Montgomery's novels, right? The heroines always had to share double billing with a place. So Anne of Green Gables, of course, starts that trend. And usually the place that's highlighted in the title is one that is a home or becomes like a home. So again, that emphasis on creating a home out of wherever you are. Some of you might be wondering why on some of the covers it's Anne of Windy Willows and some it's Anne of Windy Poplars. So it was published as Windy Willows in the UK and Australia. And also Japan. There was confusion that people might get confused, or the publisher was worried that it might get confused with The Wind in the Willows. But in Canada, it was always Anne of Windy Poplars. Okay, so as well as all of this nature in the city reflecting how Montgomery sees the world, it also reflects wider early 20th century trends towards an emphasis on public green spaces and suburbanization, which we see as, you know, Anne really emphasizes the gardens in town and then is always searching out parks and other green spaces. So now I'll give you a bit of an overview of the different ways that Anne connects to places in the towns. All right, so first of all, like I've talked about belonging a bit. Anne says that she fell in love with Windy Poplars immediately, and she gives it the highest praise for her that it reminds her of Green Gables. And in fact, the house that they've picked for this cover really almost could be Green Gables. And when she's describing falling in love with Windy Poplars, of course, its natural elements, its poplars, its other trees and flowers are bound up in that. effects, and nature is important to the belonging in this new town. Nature also beautifies the city, so I thought this was a good quote for right now. She's announcing that it's spring, and how even the most unlovely streets are transfigured by the signs of spring, even if that's just dandelions growing out of the sidewalk. So Montgomery, in her journals and her novels, is always aware of how ugly cities can be, that they can be really unpleasant and dusty, for example, and we're clearly in an urban setting here because the mention of sidewalks. But Montgomery really emphasizes the importance of nature in town, that what's unlovely in town can be transformed by the presence of nature. And even humble or kind of throwaway nature, like dandelions that we might want to get rid of, can be transformative. And Anne just assumes when she's writing this letter to Gilbert that he's not even going to be aware that it's spring, because he's so caught up in writing exams and those urban kind of schedules that he's not going to be aware of it being spring. But Montgomery reminds us that, even in town, if you look closely enough, you can be aware of and take pleasure in the seasons and the natural rhythms of the year. All right, the next one might be a bit anachronistic, but I think that Anne often does use nature as a kind of stress relief. Often the beauty of urban nature, or nature generally, helps her put things in perspective, whether that's the stress of exams or something else. It also helps her deal with one of her biggest work stresses when she's in Summerside. So she's always up against the powerful family and the Pringles in Summerside. So everyone in Summerside seems to be somehow related to the Pringles. And they're mad because their cousin was supposed to get the job. So at every turn, they're trying to thwart Anne. And so, one example of what they do is they're putting on a school play, which is kind of Anne's baby. And she has, one of the Pringles is in the starring role, is going to be Mary Queen of Scots. And this young girl comes down with the cold the morning of the play. So the Pringles think that they've got her, the play is going to be a disaster. So these are the kind of things that they get up to. So at this point, Anne is just feeling really stressed out by these various games that the Pringles play, and she goes for a walk in the on this beautiful October evening. And you can see that she says, "I couldn't help enjoying myself in spite of my Pringle worry." So kind of in typical Anne fashion, the enjoyment of nature trumps any kind of worry about this family in Summerside. But it's not just kind of a meditative, contemplative experience of nature, because then she goes on to say that she did utter a few yowls regarding the Pringles. So she's kind of taking advantage of being alone, being down by the harbor, away from people for a minute. All right. Oh, and you can see, too, that there's a student has drawn a caricature of Anne. So just another way that that year is made difficult for her. I mentioned dreaming and imagining as an important way that Anne engages with urban nature. So this is Charlottetown. The quote is describing Charlottetown. And she says how she looked across city roof and spire to the sunset, and then that's kind of a springboard to imagining her future. And what I like about that quote is that it really is urban nature, urban ecology. She doesn't turn her back on the spires. To kind of just commune with the trees or just with the natural world, kind of void of the built environment. But the two are kind of happening at once, that the city is encompassed in that view there. And so Montgomery's showing us that you can access nature in the city, you can dream in the city. Nurturing relationships are also important. Anne and Gilbert's relationship has been nurtured in various green spaces through the relationship, and this continues in Summerside. She takes his letters to read in the grove across the road. So these are some of the ways that nature in the two towns sustains Anne while she's living there. And I'm just going to finish by looking at more specifically at two spaces, the graveyard and then the ocean, to show that there are also natural spaces in the ways that I've just outlined, but they also really highlight how storytelling is linked to place, which is interesting in terms of how Montgomery's thinking about telling her stories. And she's really focused on who gets to tell their stories, who doesn't, and whose stories were told. So just to look at the graveyard for a minute, So the graveyard, and this is typical in Montgomery, is a green space. To get there, Anne has to go by ferns and trees. And Montgomery uses graveyards as green spaces that help build a sense of community, of connection to place, a sense of community history, because of course, community is literally held in a graveyard. In this instance, the first time Anne goes to the graveyard, again, it's a form of stress relief. She's feeling really put upon by the Pringles and figures that a graveyard kind of corresponds to her state of mind. She gets there, she runs into a Miss Valentine who tells her the stories of Summerside's past, and she kind of feels a bit rejuvenated, realizes it's not such a sad place after all, and that, you know, the people really came alive. So kind of this, so nature and stories are both therapeutic in this instance. A message not unsurprising coming from Montgomery, a storyteller and nature lover. But of course, also bound up in this is a bit of dark humor, because Anne says that, you know, from these stories I found out that there are some dead, or decent Pringles, dead ones. Mm-hmm. And I kind of like that line just because it's not really what we'd expect Anne of Green Gables to say. All right, so I'm going to finish by just talking about the ocean, and particularly the part of the ocean that we experience in Summerside, the harbor. There's much more return to the sea in the latest Anne books. In a lot of cases in Anne of Green Gables, we're not necessarily aware that we're on an island. We're told we are, but the ocean doesn't play a big role. So Montgomery becomes more interested in the ocean, and of course, in the context of a lecture series on island studies, it's interesting to think about Anne's island as an island. So in Anne of Green Gables, the word harbor is only used once, and it's not about the Charlottetown Harbor, whereas in Anne and Wendy Poplar's, the word comes up 33 times, so we can see that there's much more of an emphasis on how the ocean interacts with the town at the harbor. And we can see an emphasis in the sea or in the ocean on these two covers. In the background here of this one, you can see some sails that are kind of blurring into the distance. And also there's the clustering of the houses too, which kind of gesture towards a town and not a purely rural setting. In Anne of Wendy Poplar's Summerside, the winds are a constant presence, pointing to the presence of the ocean. Anne's always going for walks by the harbor. We already saw one there. There's signs of seafaring industries everywhere, so they often see the ships in the harbor. There's captains everywhere. Most of the men seem to be captains. Anne runs into a sailor with gold rings in his ears when she's out for a walk one day. There's also artifacts from the sea everywhere, so a lot of people in Summerside will deploy sea artifacts, kind of as status symbols, to kind of show their link to captains or other people with status on the sea. So for example, one family has a big white wooden woman off the bow of a famous ship belonging to a captain in their family that they display on their veranda. And so these artifacts, of course, emphasize Summerside's connection to and reliance on the sea. So the ocean has a lot of economic and cultural implications.